Kartaram Dataram Sarvasampada Lokabhiramam Sri Ramam Bhuyo Bhuyo Namamyaham. Krishna Rakshatu No Jagatraya Guruhu Krishnam Namasyamyaham Krishne Nama Rasetravo Vinihataha Krishnaya Tasmai Namaha Krishna Deva Samuthitam Jagadidam Krishnasya Dasosmyaham Krishne Tishthati Visvame Tadakilam He Krishna Rakshaswama. Jai Srimannarayana to you all. Nepal Bada Ayako Savai Bhaktahar Lai Pani Ram Raho Jai Srimannarayana. Priya Bhagat Bandho, today is Asvija Purnima. Do you know the importance of this day? A day on which Lord Krishna performed Ras Leela. This Asvija Purnima is very auspicious in that sense. He played his divine Leela and mesmerized this entire universe with his grace. Lord Krishna appeared on this earth and gave a beautiful message which we call as Bhagavad Gita in just 700 slokas. But to practice that, just a part of that, he took one avatara called Sri Rama and lived on this earth for 11,000 years. Valmiki Bhagavan beautifully says in Ramayana, Dasya Varsha Sahasrani Dasya Varsha Satani Cha Ramo Rajyam Upasitva Brahmalokam Prayasyati. He sanctified this earth with 11,000 years of his presence and set an example as how a man has to live on this earth. We call ourselves as human beings. But what does it mean by saying a man? We call ourselves as humans, right? What is a man? Walking with 2 feet becomes a man? Dressing clothes becomes a man? Speaking becomes a man? Cooking food and eating becomes a man? All these are unique abilities man only will do. Right? No animal or bird ever dresses. And they never eat cooked food. It's only man who does. But what does it mean when we want to say one person or one living creature as man? If we want to prove one as a man, what should be the very essential quality that man possesses to show that the Lord appeared on this earth and sanctified this with his gracious presence for 11,000 years. And whatever he practiced during all through the 11,000 years was spoken just in 700 slokas. See, saying is pretty easy, but practicing that, how difficult it is. In Bhagavad Gita, the Lord Krishna said, Matra sparsyastu kaunteya sitoshna sukha dukha daha agama payino nityaha tanstitikshasva bharata. He was addressing us, O man, matra sparsyaha. The physical touches, whatever we experience in this world, sometimes they are positive, sometimes they are negative. They give at times good experience, sometimes they give bad experience. They keep coming constantly. They are not ended one day. They are called matra sparshas, you know. We have skin, we get some kind of touch. Sometimes it is smooth, sometimes it is hard. Sometimes it is cold, sometimes it is, you know, heat. No, this kind of touch is just we experience. Sometimes which appears smooth, but at times that gives a negative feel. Smooth touch always gives positive feel. Is there any rule like that? No? Touching something cold, does it give always a nice feel? Not at all. If it is midsummer, yes, touching something that's cold gives a wonderful feeling. But the same thing, if you touch during January, you know what happens. So, touch is not constant. Sometimes, which appears positive, the same thing appears negative. For one, some kind of touch may give positive feel, but the same object, the same time, may give negative feel to some other person. So there is no particular rule like this gives only this kind of feel to X person. No. And same to the eyes, a color and a shape. These are two things, right? We, our eyes catch color and the form, the shape is what we catch with our eyes. And sometimes whatever we catch with our eyes may give positive feel, the same may give negative feel to some other person at the same time. And to the same person, that same object once given positive feel may give negative feel in some other time. Similarly to the ears, to the nose, to the tongue. These are called matra sparshas. Whatever we experience with our senses. They are sita, ushna, sukha, dukkha, daha. Sometimes that is cold, may give sukha. Sometimes it may give dukkha also. And sometimes ushna may give positive feel, that is sukha. And it may give negative feel as well, dukkha. Agama payinaha. Once it gave a feel, it never stays forever. Sometimes it rains, but sometimes it stops too. Sometimes the midsummer, again it passes away. They are not permanent. They keep changing from time to time, from season to season, from place to place. You know, sometimes, which is midsummer here, or midwinter in some other part of the world. And if it is midwinter here, it may be midsummer in some other part of the world. Like in Australia, you see, if it is midwinter, that's midsummer there. So, these are agama payinaha. They keep coming and going, keep coming and going. Nityaha. This happens forever. What to do? Lord Krishna said, Tam titikshasva bharata. You have to bear with them. Learn how to tolerate. Tolerance is a great quality. Maybe it is positive, maybe it is negative. Whether you like it or not, but try to learn how to tolerate. The moment you learn bearing with experiences that occur, then you will be able to see the amritatva. When something positive, don't hit the roof. When something is negative, don't drop down to the depths of the degradation, depths of the ocean. Both need not happen. Just bear with them. Learn how to tolerate the things. But it has to be shown. It has to be shown. To show these things, how to bear with the things, he took an avatara called Sri Rama. We know the story of Rama. Most of us must be knowing the story of Rama. Rama was a beloved child of Dasaratha, King Dasaratha. Of course, after so many years, Dasaratha got a child like Rama. So lovely boy. Father used to feel joy. Mom used to feel joy. People used to feel joy. Everybody. There was no one who felt joy by seeing Rama. So his name became Rama. Ramayati iti Rama. You know? He pleases everybody. And by seeing him, everybody feels tremendous joy, ecstasy. That was Rama. And such a boy was asked to go after a great sage called Vishwamitra. Just he was 12-year-old boy. 12 years. And barefooted. Walking in the forest. No chariot was provided. No pocket money. No, at least a plastic card to draw some money when needed. And he didn't ask the father, Father, I'm going to the forest along with sage Vishwamitra. But if I need something, whom should I ask? Neither child asked, nor dad informed. Just said, go. That's all it is. He started following Vishwamitra. For 10 days, he was walking, walking and walking. No beautiful beds, no AC rooms. Only leafy bed, organized by his brother. He slept on the floor. That was the way he spent his time in the forest, you know, when he went along with Vishwamitra. But he never said, why should I? Why should I go? He didn't ask his dad or his mom. Because dad said, I should follow. That's it. And he never cried. Vishwamitra gave him many benefits, wonderful surprises. After giving that to protect his yajna, he asked Rama to stand guard for it. And Rama, day in and out for 6 days, no sleep, no food, no even probably drank a drop of water, because nobody has supplied a bottle, water bottle. Because the demons may come at any moment. They may spoil the yajna the sage was performing with Vishwamitra. And Vishwamitra sat in silence. He never speaks. Once he started the sacrifice, the fire sacrifice, he doesn't speak at all. Maunam asritaha. So he sits in silence. And he said, this is Shadratram, the sacrifice I am doing for 6 nights and 1 day. I mean 7 days. Starting from the beginning, Rama and Lakshmana were just guarding the sacrifice, the yaga. Marija and Subahu came on the 7th day, not during all the 6 days. And without sleep, Rama was guarding. And Rama didn't ask, why should I? I need some rest. I need some snacks and food. He didn't ask. He was just bearing with it. When Vishwamitra has given some astras and shastras, he accepted. And when he wanted him to stand guard for the yaga, he stood for it and fulfilled the duty what is rested upon him. As a result of that, a wonderful jackpot. He got Sita. If Vishwamitra was not there, I am sure Rama wouldn't have got Sita at all. So Vishwamitra was really pleased with Rama's obedience, Rama's vinayam. We call it as vinayam. You know, he was really benevolent to the great sage. His acharya accepted him as acharya and did all services to him. And then, as a result of that, he got just wonderful Sita. Not only he got, Vishwamitra organized a marriage for all the four brothers. You know, in fact, Dasaratha was much worried. You know, how to perform the marriage celebration to my child, because he born from the payasam. You know, how to make marriage? He was a kind of, you know, just doubt. But Vishwamitra made the things very easy. And Rama just obeyed the instructions of his dad and his guru. And he wonderfully succeeded. He attained wonderful things. Came back to Ayodhya, and it was not just enough bed of roses. Again, his stepmother Kaikeyi asked him to go to the exile forest. Not for a day or two, for 10 days. It was for long 14 years. And Rama did not say, why should I go? Come on, ask for majority opinion. If majority says I should go, then I will go, otherwise I won't. He didn't say that. When time provoked him to go to the forest, without a single word, he convinced his mom, convinced his father, convinced his ministers and people as well, and he left for the forest. even the days were not sweet in the forest. He faced many demons, but he faced. And he was with great sages. He served. Sometimes it was sweet, sometimes it was so soaring, but he was able to bear with both of the things equally, but never give up his righteous practices. Even thus, he was not permitted to stay. Came Ravana and Marij in the guise of a deer and separated both Sita and Rama. And he took it, a challenge, not giving up his own practices because he was a man. He said he was a man. He wanted to set an example for the man as how one has to conduct himself. Sometimes our life may go through hardships. Sometimes it may be smooth sailing. And you have to bear with it. You should not cry. And you have to just accept the things as it is and push yourself ahead. There are so many Nepali people here. Do you know that? It was a time when they were crossing through so much hardships in just a refugee camp for long, long, long years. Almost, I think they stayed for about 14 to 20 years. God blessed them, brought them to America. They are not computer engineers like you guys. They did not do MCA and IIT. But God brought them to US with wonderful citizenship cards. It was a time, you know, it was a soaring experience for them during those days. They crossed through, but God showed them a wonderful avenue, a wonderful chance, you know, to come to this country and just live by themselves. Life is really an amazing feat. One has to take it and one has to stand for the values. One has to push himself ahead with a duty that is ordained to him. That's what Krishna said, you know, you have to follow your duty. Let things come, Sita, Ushna, Sukha, Dukkha, Daha. Let anything come, but bear with it. And you see the result of it. What would be the result? That is what he said next in the next sloka of second chapter, Bhagavad Gita. Yam hi na vyadhayantyete purusham purusharshabha samadukha sukham dhiram somrutatvaya kalpate. Yam hi navyadhayanti yam hi ete matras parsaha navyadhayanti. When you feel touches like positive and negative, and when you are not disturbed by those things, during the positiveness you never, you know, jump up, and during the negative feel you won't shrink. Yam hi na vyadhayantyete purusham samadukha sukham dhiram. Whoever is able to bear with these things equally, maybe it is dukkha or maybe it is sukha, who accepts them as sama, equal, somrutatvaya kalpate, he only attain eternity. He experiences nectarious joy. It is called Amritatva. He attains divine bliss always. So Amritatvaya Kalpate, no one else, no other, who will be always, you know, just carried away with the feelings that he experiences, he will not attain Amritatva. We want Amritatva. I think everybody wants Amritatva, right? Not only you or I, but even an ant wants to experience that Amritatva. And even the four-headed Brahma wants to experience that Amritatva. Everybody likes to experience that Amritatva. But is it possible? Who will experience that? That is what Lord Krishna revealed to the humanity. So Amritatvaya Kalpate, he will become fit for the experience. Who is able to bear everything equally? How to bear with it? Is it with the body or with mind? Somebody asked us, Swamiji, when we touch the fire, we should not cry. When we touch the snow, ice cube, we should not feel, ah. Is it what you want us to be? I said, for sure, no. Only one will be like that who is not living. If you keep him in the fire, he never says, ah. When you keep him in the ice box, you know, waiting for some relatives or stuff like that, but he never says, oh, it is too cold. Only that person says, right? He never responds, he never reacts, because for him, either fire or ice, both are same. He treats both equal. Do we want to be like that? No, for sure. So Krishna doesn't say that the physical reactions will be there. If you touch, yes, it burns. And if you touch, yes, it, because of its coldness, yes, it burns. Physically, the reactions will be there. But he says, sama dukkha sukham dhiram. Dhira is the one who is wise with his intelligence. Dhya ramate, whose intellect works well and who becomes wise in receiving both of them. See, now it is raining. Are you stopping your work? Are you cursing the clouds? Are you asking God, you know, God, stop these rains because we have to go to the temple? Are you asking God like that? We won't. We say, okay, this is the law of this land. That's all it is. God made this land like this. Come on. Let us search for alternatives as how best we'll be able to bear with it. Either by wearing a raincoat or by holding an umbrella. Just we keep going. We don't want the rain should be stopped, and we don't want to stop our activity as well. But at the same time, we don't want to be soaked also. We don't want to be drenched in the water. So we hold an umbrella and our work is done. Rain is there, season is not changed, and we didn't stop our activity. Bear with it. Same even when it is a hot summer. Bear with it. Same with any experience of the life. Bear with it. If you are able to bear with the things and still just keep continuing your mission, you attain success. And you enjoy the bliss. saha amrutatvaya kalpate. Rama showed that it is necessary for a man to bear with all those things. Rama considered himself a real human being. Though it was Vishnu who appeared as Ramachandra, but he never said that I am God. Even when all the devatas appeared before him and said, "Hey Ram, why you have to put Sita in a test? It's not necessary, because do you know who you are? Bhavan Narayano Devaha Sita Lakshmihi Swayam. You are Lord Narayana himself and Sita is Lakshmi. What a test needed for Sita? She can sanctify even the fire." Rama, with folded hands, said, "It's okay. I'm a man. I'm just a man. That's all it is. Because I'm born and I have father. I have a place. Atmanam manusham manye Rama dasaradhatmajam." In other words, he wants to say that a man should conduct this way his life. Let any kind of things encountered, but bear with them. Stop not your mission in doing good things. Keep doing and just go ahead. That's a beautiful message he has given during his Rama Avatara. But whatever he practiced during the 11,000 years, Lord Krishna said in just a couple of slokas. In just two slokas. You can imagine to practice the rest of the slokas, how long it takes for a man to really practice the essence of Gita. It's not only the Rama, even during Krishna Avatara, he also practiced and showed that, you know, being God himself. Krishna expressed several times, "Oh, do you know who am I? I'm God." Not once or twice he said. Just at the moment he born in the jail, he said, "I'm God." Because he appeared with four hands, having all the ayudhas in his hands, all the devatas appeared in the jail and started praising Devaki. You know, for allowing or for bringing such a great God onto this earth as a little baby. And then, when mom Yashoda was offering birth, you know, they apply the turmeric. They take the turmeric stick and then while offering the bath, they clean the tongue also. I don't know whether that practice is existing still in many families or not. But in a very, very few families, you know, which are very, very traditional, and then they do this kind of thing. Now, it is of course doctors objected anyway. But back our homes, our mother, when offering the bath during the young age, you know, they clean the tongue with the turmeric sticks. During the time when mom opened her mouth, then she was able to see the whole universe in his divine mouth. And again, there was another occasion when Balarama complaining to Yashoda, he ate mud. Amma tammudu mannu tinenamma. And mom wanted him, "Come on, open your mouth and show me." Then he opened his mouth and entire universe reappeared. And mom was, you know, scared. Not once or twice, I say several times he exhibited or he shown that I'm God. But even for him, life was not on the bed of roses, you know. But do you ever see that Lord Krishna changing his face? Always smiling, always smiling. So many demons. On the very seventh day, there was Putana. During third month, there was Sekatasura. And whole his young age, up to 14 years, when he was in Nanda Gokula, and every day there was some asura. Sometimes Domasura, sometimes Chimasura, sometimes Yigasura. And every object is an asura. No matter whether it's ant asura and fly asura. Everything became asuric. But he never cried. He just faced all the hurdles that encountered him. 15th year he came to Dwarka. He came to Madhura. And even there also the same thing. Kamsa arranged a few things. He faced them all. He went to a great Acharya Sandipani. No? To learn great knowledge, to obtain good knowledge, who used to live in Kasi, in Banaras. 64 days he lived there and he learned all the 64 arts. And he thought probably the Guruji may be asking moksha. But to his disappointment, Guruji said, give me some time. I go to my wife and seek her permission. You know, after she said, I want my last children. And this person came and asked, hey Krishna, seems that you are God himself. And there's nothing that you cannot do. So please bring back my children whom I lost. And it was a great disappointment for Krishna, you know. He thought that he may be asking moksha. But he didn't. He thought Pandavas asked moksha, but they did not. He created many situations where at least they may ask, but they did not. Sometimes they asked for food, sometimes they asked for war, sometimes they asked for something else. Every now and then when he gave chances, they were just asking for something or else, for other. But finally, it was the Lord who wanted to make things in a way so that they ask. Thus he created a war. Do you think Lord cannot really make the understanding between the brothers? He can. But he didn't want that to happen. Do you know why? For the sake of Draupadi. They were very bad guys. You know, they tried to insult a lady in a big assembly, Draupadi. And Krishna thought this is something which we can never excuse at all. When he was going as an ambassador on behalf of Pandavas, then all the Pandavas said, all the five, at least give us five villages, it's okay. If five villages are not possible, at least give us five streets in a village. So each one will rule. Even if that's also not possible, give us a big apartment where there are five bedrooms. We somehow try to adjust. Even that is also not possible, you know, give a condominium. Wait, there are just 5 beds. And finally he came to Draupadi and asked, "Hey Draupadi, what is your message to Kauravas?" She said, "Krishna, I just can't say anything. But see my hair, totally undressed. And would you like that I have to dress this hair? To dress this hair, few things are should be done. Do you allow me to dress my hair, please?" Because in those days, they were not keeping their hair free. In those days, they always used to keep the hair dressed well, and also, you know, tied up well, decorated with flowers and stuff like that. It was those days, you know, for one lady. So she said, "Are you asking me to keep my hair just, you know, undressed like this?" Then Krishna said, "That is for which I am going now. I want to see that it is dressed well. To dress it well, somebody's chest must be torn. Somebody's thigh must be broken. That happens only war. Without war, that will not happen. And if Dharmaraja, Yudhishthira and others say, 'Om Shanti, Om Shanti, Om Shanti,' do you think that it happens then? So, Draupadi, don't worry. Dyaupadet, Prudhivi Siryet, Himavanva Sekali Bhavet, Tushyet Toyanithihi Krishne, Name Mogham Vacho Bhavet. I promise you, I see that your hair is dressed properly. Let even the sky fall at break, Himalayas may become pieces, let the oceans dry up, my word to you will never fail. Okay? Be happy. I'm going now." He left. He made the whole war to happen. You know? And even then, Pandavas did not ask for any good message from Lord Krishna. That is where Krishna tightened the screws of Arjuna. So the Arjuna, the same Arjuna, who said, "I'm very powerful, I can kill all these guys with single hand. Dhartarashtrasya durbuddhehe Yudhe Priyachikir Shavaha. Let me see who are the right warriors to fight with me. And with whom should I give the fight? Take the chariot amidst both of battalions and let me see who is there." Who asked the same question? And the same guy said, "I don't want to wage the war." Why it happened? Do you think such thing happens at the same moment? He asked, "Take my chariot." And Krishna brought the chariot amidst both the war fields and said, "Look." The moment he looked, something else appeared before him, because the one standing behind or the one standing in front of him is not an ordinary person. So everyone appeared indifferent. Earlier he saw only enemies, but now he saw relatives. That is the time when Krishna tightened his screws. And Arjuna said, "Shishyasteham syadhimaham tvam prapannam. I surrender to you, my Lord. I am your disciple. Teach me something that is good." "My God, at last you ask now. You would have asked this long ago when I met with you first time. But you never asked. You never felt like asking. And nobody asked that. He came with a beautiful message. But without asked, I think the good messages should not be told. Napurshtaha kasyachit bruyat is the Vedic rule. Without asking, good messages cannot be revealed. You know, if somebody did not ask and you started saying something, they thought that you are crazy. You must have seen, you know, in countries like India, there will be a traffic police, you know, standing in somewhere in the middle, and he shows the ways. They come this way, go this way, like this. Right? And imagine a fine morning when you are just traveling by and a police cop comes to you and start telling you, hey, this way goes to Seattle, this way goes to DC, this way goes to somewhere else, this way goes... If he started saying all these things, how do you feel? Who asked you? Did I ask you to say which way goes where? No, because you may not be missing. That's why I say, mind your own business. you simply think that he's a crazy guy. That's why powerful messages will be revealed by those people only to them who ask. So without asking, they should not be told. And nobody asks him, so no, what to do? So Lord Krishna created a situation where Arjuna asks. So he asked at last, you know, I am really not able to judge whether I have to wage the war or stop the war. Yachreyasyan nischitam bruhitanme. Whatever is good, tell me. Here Krishna caught hold of him. He asked, whatever is good to me, tell that. What did he ask? Whether to fight or not to fight. Only two things. Right? Krishna would have just said, you know, just fight. Finish. No Bhagavad Gita. But Arjuna asked, yachreyasya, whatever is good to me, tell that. So that good, what is good? What is good to the body? What is good to the mind? What is good to the soul? What is good to the world? What is good to everything, everybody? That has to be told now. So he started Bhagavad Gita and just revealed it. Not for sake of Arjuna. You understand? Don't think it is for Arjuna's sake. For us, he has given the message. But even for him, the days were not so positive. So many people made so many complaints against him. Threw so much dirt against him, but he was so untouched. He is so untouched. He will be so untouched. Namam karmani rimpanti, he declared, because he never owns anything. That is what is required. And he accepted everything equal. Somebody said positive, somebody said negative. Okay. Whatever you feel like saying, just say. That's okay. Well, I am untouched. Some people said he is a thief. You know, he steals butter and yogurt and milk. I said, that's okay. But who gave you the milk? Huh? Who gave milk to the Nandavraj people? Is it their own property? It was only a thorny area earlier, but he took a beautiful sankalpa with which it was wonderfully became a greenery, green area with grass. And then cattle came, and behind the cattle people came, and that's how the Vrindavana was organized there. And even then Krishna went there. With his touch, those cows were growing. With his flute, they were growing. They did not graze the grass and they did not drink the water. They drank the flute. the voice of the flute, the sound of the flute when he was playing. That was their food. And by seeing him, by his touch, when he used to take the cattle to the forest and when he used to bring them back home, he used to touch every cow. That was the food for the cow. That's how they became so stout, big. That's how they used to give wonderful milk, creamy milk. That's how they used to... Whose is this? It's he who gave everything. And that to whom that yogurt, butter, milk, ghee, to whom do they belong? Krishna. And he gave everything and they stolen everything. They are real thieves. Right? Given by Krishna and they declared that they are their properties. That means who are the thieves then? To reduce their sin, he started taking something from them. So that the amount of punishment will be reduced. And they started blaming him as thief. See how wonderful it is? No, how surprising it is? How ironical it is? All we are thieves, in fact. Because the soul here belongs to him. The body he gave to us. But my body? And this is mine. We are stealing his properties. Who are thieves then? We. To reduce our sins, to remove from these bondages, he gave a beautiful message. Bearing with all the things that we are throwing on to him. So, my friends, what I mean today, it is the tolerance that makes one to be called as a real man. We worship Lord Krishna and we worship him in the form of Lord Rama because we have to get a message. As Krishna, he spoke. As Rama, he practiced. So practice like Rama and follow Lord Krishna. Take the message from Lord Krishna. Practice like Rama. Don't practice like Krishna. And don't expect any messages from Rama. Rama never gives messages. He simply practices. He's a man of practice. See him and learn. Listen from Krishna and then follow him. It's a beautiful way of living the Lord gave us on this earth for ultimate moksha. Because it's the driving factor behind our lives is karma. So until and otherwise we cut down the karmic bondage, we cannot really get moksha, for which he came down all the way and showed us. Practice like this, you will be coming out of the bondages. That's why every day we do some puja. Every day we do. Not only during weekends. That's why our organizers choose a weekday for you to do the puja. Because most of you people, I think, assemble during the weekends and of course keep doing pujas, right? But keep doing it every day, not necessarily weekends. Swamiji, every day it's not possible because we have offices. No? Early morning we have to push into the car ourselves and then go and only we come late in the night. How can we do puja, please? How much time sincerely can you dedicate for God, tell me? Sincerely, every day, if at all you want to give. How much time? And?
Half an hour maximum.
How many of you can give half an hour? Yes, can you raise your hands, please? Sincerely, I say. Half an hour. My goodness. Number looks so big. Okay. Let me give another option. 15 minutes, how many people can you give? 15 minutes. Can you tell me how many of you are able to give 5 minutes? At least? 5 minutes. Poor God has to depend upon you for time. Can I ask you one thing? How much time you are able to give for breathing a day?
24 hours.
Take a couple of hours. You don't? It's okay, but you are breathing, right? Whether you think it or not, but you are breathing, right? Breathing is for body. For the survival of the body, you breathe. But for the survival of the soul, you have to do the puja. If you won't breathe, what happens? Who dies? It's only body will die. It's only body will die. You won't die. But if you won't do puja, you will die. How many of you are interested in living? Tell me now. How many of you are interested in living? You living. Then in a day, how long would you like to live? 24 hours. Then keep doing puja 24 hours. But Swamiji, it's not practical. You may say so.